the second half of the show fired up. We're going to do like another vampire girl. This one we're going to kind of goof around with, just kind of see what we're doing. But this piece is the 2014 Michelle. If you guys have been paying attention, my assistant, Michelle.
Hello.
Who's actually here tonight. What I usually do is I do a portrait of her every year. Usually because I'm lazy, it ends up being the last month of the year. So this is the one for this year. And usually what she ends up doing is making this her like Facebook portrait for like a few months or so. So usually a year until the next one replaces it. So this will be her portrait for the next year on Facebook if you guys ever wanna like pay her a visit or anything like that.
So before we take it away, talk about the medium real quickly.
This was done, and I try to kind of mix it up every year with these. I try to do something a little bit different, and this year I decided to do it in oils. I've done it in watercolors. I've done it in a rub out technique, and I've done it in watercolors, charcoal, just about everything. So I'm actually getting to the point where I'm running out of, you know, mediums to use, but I don't do oils very very often, and I kind of use this as an opportunity to kind of play around with oils for her. So this is it's oils, but this is actually water soluble oils. It's Holbein, one of the companies that I use a lot of their stuff. They make a product called Dual Oils, and that's it's oils, it's water soluble. And the tricky thing about it is it's actual oils, and you can mix it with true oils, but they've done something to the oil itself to make it water soluble. And it's kind of a misnomer to say it's water soluble oils. I mean, it is water soluble. You actually can't use water as a medium. You can't use water to thin the paints down or anything like that. Well, you can, but the paints become like really awful. I mean, it's exactly like you would think about mixing like water and oil together. It's just kind of becomes really weird and chunky. But if you use like, they have a linseed medium that goes along with it. And when you use that, it's really exactly like painting with regular oils. The nice thing about using these water soluble oils is instead of using turpentine to have to clean out my brushes, which, you know, I don't like, I can use just regular soap and water and clean my brushes out. So I don't have to like make the studio smell like, you know, turpentine for like weeks after doing a painting. But this is a lot of fun. In fact, I always enjoy doing these. I try to do something quick and expressive every year, and just kind of have fun with it. So this is another year gone by, and another portrait of my favorite assistant.
Ta-da. Also, just so everybody knows, I will not friend you on Facebook. So stop trying. Yes. If yes. I don't know you, stop trying.
And there you go.
Now the thing about it is, I never mentioned that she was nice or anything like that.
I never mentioned that she was
sweet or anything like that.
I think Facebook is a little fast and loose with the word friend. Is all I have to say. Yeah.
I'm just
saying. Of course, that's coming from the guy who has a Facebook account just to do the Stealth Freeze group. So there you all go. Right.
Now what we have here is we're gonna do another bunny girl. We're gonna do another vampire girl, and this one's going to be a Playboy bunny vampire girl. Robert throws these things out there. I don't know where he gets them from, but they are a lot of fun. So that's what we're going to do here. And again, it's going to be a bit of a portrait. This is going to be a little bit quicker than the last piece, mainly because my girlfriend is at home, and you know, she's just about to fire up the Steelers game and some food. So you know, that means that I'm not going to be working here for much too longer, but you know, we're just gonna kind of goof around, throw some paint at this board, and see what happens. again, I'm using watercolors. So what I've done is I've got a trusty piece of Gator board, which is basically like foam board, but it's like foam board Zilla. It's like a really tough, very strong piece of foam core. And I have no idea what is going to transpire here, but when I was in the art supply store the other day, I found this stuff that's slightly tinted watercolor paper. And they had it in like a green, they had it in some pink color and some just really bizarre colors, but they also had this really light gray color. And I thought, man, that sounds really cool to be able to do a watercolor on a slightly tinted board. And I really wanted to kind of sort of play around with it and just see what it does. So I've never painted on this paper before. I have no idea how it's going to behave. I'm hoping that it's friendly. So I'm just going to jump in and see what it does, you know, see what we can get out of it. But the plan is to do like a Playboy bunny
vampire.
That's the plan. Okay. And you know, while we're working on this, again, you know, where Robert and I tried to kind of set this up, like you're kind of hanging out in the studio with us. So if you have any questions or anything like that, go ahead and send a message to Robert or send a message to the Facebook group, or if you're watching this through YouTube or Twitter or anything like that, go ahead and feel free to, you know, kick messages our way, and we'll try our best to handle them as much as we can, and answer any questions. I'm going to try my best to shop talk throughout all of this. So really, if you've got any questions about the equipment that I'm using, I'm going to try to explain everything while I'm doing it. But like, if you have any questions along the way, throw those questions out there, and we'll see if we can kind of pick those up and answer those from us.
So Anna says, when we say Playboy bunny vamp, you mean it's a guy who's a playboy who picks up women wearing a bunny suit, right?
No.
It's gonna be what you think.
Yeah.
Don't worry, we'll work on that.
Yeah.
Well, we had a couple ideas for some guy vampires, but since we were only gonna knock out a couple of them tonight, we decided to do babes. So.
Yes. So you know, again, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start this off using the trusty see if I can get a good shot of this, the Pilot Eno pencil. This is you can get this this pencil, this mechanical pencil, and the it's weird saying lead when it's not really made of lead.
It's material?
Yeah, and the material that's for the stick, and what And we are back. again, you can get the Pilot Eno pencil from Jet Pens. A lot of my you know, pencils and stuff like that, I just get it from Jet Pens. And those guys at JetPens.com, those guys have some of the fastest shipping you can possibly imagine. So hang out with those guys. They'll absolutely take care of you. Reference. I'm going to use any reference I could possibly get my hands on for this. I've got like you know, a few reference shots of Playboy bunnies that's actually on my screen that I can look at for reference for the uniform. Even though, because this is primarily a portrait, I'm not going to be doing much of the uniform, but it's kind of to kind of give me an idea of exactly where I'm going with this. And we talked about it a little bit the last time, but I am very quick to reference. What I'm going to do is I'm going to grab references as quickly as I possibly can. And if I don't know it, I'm going to reference it. If I don't know it, I'm not going to try my best to make it up. I'm going to reference it just immediately. So that's one of the things that I always try to make a point of, is I'd rather reference it and learn it rather than make it up and run the possibility of getting it wrong. Every once in a while, let's get Joan back in here. This is Joan, my trusty mannequin head. And a lot of times what I'll do is I'll use her for reference a lot of times. If it's something that I have kind of a question about, I'm very quick to pick her up and turn her at whatever dramatic angle I need. If it's not one of the angles of the head that I don't have loaded in my brain already. And like I said, I use it as an opportunity to learn more so than, anytime you look at reference, do not consider it a crutch, you know. I think doing bad drawings without reference is a crutch, but taking the time to use reference, that's actually a really cool thing. As normal, what I personally like doing is just kind of getting in and slashing and burning and just kind of just, I know that the first stuff that I draw is probably not going to be there in the end. So every drawing and every bit of style that I have, I consider the sum of my mistakes. So what I try to do is I try to not have any fear and get those mistakes down there. So what I'm doing here is kind of setting things up, getting an idea of sort of the angle, you know, sort of the head that I want to use. And the cool thing about doing things this way is, if I draw it too big at first, that's really not that big a deal. I can kind of go in and I can kind of change things and do whatever I need as I need it. So I can just kind of fumble around until I get it right. I don't know if you guys can see the stuff with this red pen that easily. But if you could see it, you would understand that, man, it's pretty harsh. And the cool thing is what I want to do is give her kind of a classic hairstyle, kind of a more of a, that sort of 60s kind of flip. All right, and I'm just kind of looking at the cloud that I've got down here of just stuff, and I'm pretty happy with where this is going. So so now I'm gonna start making some marks to actually really kind of declare, you know, what I want to do. And this I'm gonna be a little bit less realistic than the last piece, and a little bit, I wouldn't say cartoony. That one, I'm sorry. Oh, you need the next box down. Yeah. And go to the second one.
This one?
Yeah. And hit save. And that should give us our sound back.
Booyah!
All right, so I'm just kind of jumping in here and kind of getting her cuteness down. All right, and I think. Don't really need Joan for any more of this. And what I'm going to do is, and I'll go back and forth on this, where I'm just going to soften things up with the eraser a little bit. And a lot of times, especially when I'm working with the Pilot Nino, I mean, I'm doing pretty much a straight watercolor approach to this, so I don't have to be real careful about making sure that I protect the integrity of the paper. But a lot of times, if I'm a little bit concerned with how much abuse I'm kind of visiting onto the paper, what I'll do is I'll just kind of roll the paper, where I'm just kind of going over it with my kneaded eraser, but I'm kind of rolling it rather than scrubbing the eraser on it. And what that does is that since the Pilot Nino is just such a soft pencil, and it just really, I mean, it is probably the most erasable pencil that I've ever used. It's several times more erasable than the Colorize pencils. Okay, so I've got like a kind of a basic ghost of what I need in here. So I'm going to go in and be a little bit more deliberate about her anatomy. And because I'm going a little bit more kind of cartoony with her, I'm going to be a little bit more exaggerated about her eyes. You know, and what I'm going to do with this is the drawing part, or is the last piece that I did. The drawing was completely eliminated by the time you got to the end of the piece, but on this piece, the drawing is going to actually play a part in the end of the piece. So I'm making sure my drawing is a little bit more deliberate. I want her to have kind of a nice little cute smile, so. That's kind of the storytelling that I'm going for with this is just a juxtaposition, where like yeah, at a glance it's like, oh wow, it's a cute little Playboy bunny, but you know, pay a little bit more attention and you see that something a little bit dangerous about her. And the last drawing, it was really important to structure the shadows just right. But like I said, with this drawing, it's really about starting with a really good solid drawing, and using the watercolors to kind of tint that drawing. So I want her to have like a nice big wide-eyed expression. I mean, I think the way that I'm sort of thinking about this is almost like I'm doing a chef's choice feast. If you guys are familiar with that, when I'm at conventions, sometimes I'll do an illustration, and it's black and white illustration, but I'll do like a little bit of color work onto it. But I want her to have like those big dark eyes, like those classic bunnies would have. In fact, I'd like to go even more exaggerated than that. And what I'm doing is like, I think with the eyes, the classic look is those hooded eyes. So what I'm doing is exposing as much of her eyeball as possible, just really opening the eye up there. And kind of make her look nice and kind of doughy. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to really, even though her eyes are going to be really wide open, I'm going to just do a major hood, you know, on her eyes. So I'm gonna sort of put her her actual eyelid, and then I'm just gonna go for this major hood, you know, over her eyes. Yeah. So her eyes are wide open, but they're still like really hooded. And that is a way that I try to go for that really kind of very doughy, wide-eyed kind of innocence. I'm gonna give her like way too pronounced eyelashes. And I'm kind of happy with that look. Now what I wanna do is I wanna go for few days, so it's kind of like I've got bow ties down. That's something that I can handle without reference. So again, I'm putting it down, and all right. Hey, looks like we're, for some reason, man, Google is just having a hard time with this.
We may have taxed its limits.
Okay.
Yeah, we found that the last time we were on Justin TV, we were good for a while, and then when it started, you know, going hinky, the hinkiness came in greater frequency.
It seems like Google's saying, hey, wrap it up here.
You guys have used enough bandwidth.
All right, so I think we're good to go with what we have here, and actually, what's cool is here, I'm not trying to do too much work, actually, on her hair to separate the hair from the rest of her, because I really want it to kind of almost blend seamlessly in. I want it to go from her head right into the background, you know, sort of with just ease. And now what I'm going to do is just kind of go in and do like a little bit of line art. What I'm going to use is I'm going to use a Tombow pen. And this is a Tombow brush pen. And it's kind of weird because it seems like every bit of equipment that Tombow makes in America is just bad. But this Tombow pen from Japan is completely awesome. This is another item that you can pick up at Jet Pens, and I think it costs like $2.50 or something like that. But I use this to do comics when I'm actually working on paper. It is an absolutely fantastic pen. In fact, this pen, now that I'm using this, I don't actually have to use quill pens anymore. Which, oh man, oof, I'm glad I'm freed from that torture. And because this is a brush pen, I get to really get some nice thicks and thins. Like I said, I'm gonna super exaggerate these eyelashes. Just really try to.
Scott Reed says Google can't handle the bunny.
Google can't handle the bunny.
Or no, excuse me. That Anna said Google can't handle the bunny.
So it's really nice to be able to kind of, just with one pen, get every line that I want. You know, get everything from those nice, thick, juicy lines to really super thin. Like hairlines with this, you know. Plus, it's for all intents and purposes, it's kind of like a marker, so you really get great control over what you're doing. And again, I'm just kind of setting things up here. And because this is going to be a little bit more open, I'm really not concerning myself so much with the complexities of black, white, gray composition or anything like that. This is just really kind of having fun with it. And not only that, but I'm not going to really kill myself to do everything in black and white. I'm going to sort of try to leave a little room for me to describe some things in color. And something I like doing with, if I'm doing like extra cute girls, like a lot of times I don't end the smile at the corner of their mouths. I'll just kind of do a line first and then, you know, adds a little cartooniness to the smile, but it also makes them a little bit more mischievous. Now that I'm on the edge of the face here, I can actually push down a little bit harder, really get the edge of the pen. So you can really kind of see the difference between using this pen rather than a normal magic marker. And the cool thing about this is an archival pen, but at the same time, the ink that it lays down is waterproof. And that's a really important game, is making sure that you're working with an ink that's going to be waterproof. And I'm really trying to be very careful about the choices that I make as to what parts to do in black and what parts just kind of leave out there. Because some parts of this I want to do in black and some parts of it I want to sort of do in other colors. And some parts of this are going to be, you know, really about the painting. And other parts are going to be parts that are really going to be very subtle and exist only in color. So with the way that I want to handle this, I think I'm going to leave her hair and kind of relatively open for color. And I'll go in and handle some of this stuff. And what I'm doing is I'm doing the same thing that I did with the previous piece. I'm kind of really making deliberate decisions as to what parts are going to be part of my subject and what parts I just want to kind of fall away from the illustration. Okay, like the way this is going. So let me switch over to some color on some of this. And Rob's going to jump in and take some shots for
Facebook.
Yeah, all the other medium. And what I'm going to do here is do a couple of things to just really kind of enhance pieces of this. But at the same time, I really would like to set things up for color. And not get in there and actually draw every part of it. So what I'll do is I wanted to have some gorgeous big blue eyes. And I know the blue is going to mix with the red that's down there, and sort of desaturate the blue a little bit. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mostly erase her pupils out, and any place else where feel that that red is kind of sneaking in. And the cool thing about this red is it's going to disappear. So if you, even if I left the red there, if you hang it on a wall in 6 months or so, the red will just eventually just be gone. So now I'm going to take, and this is a Faber-Castell pit pen. And what I'll do is I'll use this to kind of establish just the edge of her eyes there. Again, I want her to have just really very, very blue eyes. And her eyes are going to be the subject of this piece, by the way. So I really want those eyes to like not miss. Now I'm coming in and edging some of the some of this stuff with some color. And again, what I'm doing here is I'm really setting up this for when I come in and actually put down the color. So this is just the real setup here. So I can actually, in fact, since a lot of this red's going to disappear, I don't want that red in there forcing my hand. So I'm just going to soften that red up so that I realize all the places I actually need to work. I'm just going to go in. Her hair is eventually going to be blonde. So I'm just going to go in and establish. And, you know, a look that I like with you know, a lot of the classic blondes is how their flesh tone almost goes right into their hair. And you can't really see the difference between the flesh tone and the hair. It's just almost just one large shape. Is that you?
Louis is going nuts. Louis is like in love with this piece. I'm telling you, he's like, you know, I'm getting a million little text messages and dad jokes. Love the blue eyes. She can totally drain me dry. I'm a sucker. I kill me. Oh, he's too funny.
Again, just kind of setting things up here. Just kind of making sure that that we have a really nice base. And, you know, path of interest is going to be going through here. So everything that happens on the back of our head really doesn't matter. That's not really that important to the illustration. What's important to that illustration is for me to get that that path right. And what I'm going to do is now that I've got this in, and you can see that this is a very open illustration here, and I really like doing that type of stuff where it's really open. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to really make the lighting on this kind of work for me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set up things with dioxazine violet, and it's a kind of my approach to doing this type of transparent paintings, because I know everything is going to be transparent. What I'd like to do is I'd like to kind of establish all my dark values ahead of time. And if I have all my dark values established ahead of time, what I can do is I can just throw washes at this and just kind of not be concerned about making sure that my values are really right, because what I'm doing is I'm getting my values right in the beginning. And again, deoxyzine violet is a really nice way to go with this. Now, with how I want to set this up, again, you know, I want to really kind of bring out her blue eyes. So that gives me a couple of options. Option number one is I can, let me find blue. And usually what I try to do at first on my color wheel is put my key color, and my key color is my subject color, which is her eyes. I'll put the key color on the bottom of the color wheel, so here, and then I'll put all the other colors up here, and I'll kind of look at that and go, will that give me what I want? Basically all these colors opposed to this nice pure blue-green. And that looks good. I can go over here and get a little bit more yellow. I can go over here and just go for pure blue. And that way I can bring in yellows and oranges. So let me see, blue-green gives me orangey-yellow. I think orangey-yellow is gonna be enough. I don't need to have pure yellow as part of my composition. So so this is what I'm going with. I'm happy with this color theory here. So I'll put that up here to keep myself honest. So blue is gonna be for the eyes. Everything else is gonna be featured in here. In fact, let's go. Just push it a little bit more so I can have some of the, so let me go slightly blue-green because I want some of that purple to show through in the end. And if I go, you know, green-blue, that's going to be like a little bit too, the purple isn't going to be justified. So I'm going to move it over here just a little bit. I can't go quite yellowy-orange, but I can add a little bit of white to the orange and get like a really close effect. And again, I reserve the right to cheat if I have to.
So you got a question here. How much do you concentrate on the path on the comic panels? Is it different than the pieces you do for fans or like, you know, these kind of like commission pieces?
Mm-hmm. Generally it is. With comics, because that's a different thing, with a comic, I'm concentrating on not the path of detail, but I'm concentrating on the path of action. So I want there to be kind of a wave of motion going through a comic book panel, which is going to be kind of a slightly different approach to it. So I'm really thinking in terms of if I want the path to go this way through the comic book panel, what I'm thinking of is, oh, well, let me have this guy bending his arm this way, and let me have this thing over here, and this thing over here, and this swash in the background going in that direction. So that it's still a path, but instead of it being a path of detail, it's a path of action. All right, now I'm gonna set up everything with this deoxyzine. And this is a fun color. This the nice thing about this color is a great enhancer. I mean, it's barely a color itself because it's so deep, but it's like it's a very deep and rich color. A lot of times when colors get dark, they get very neutral and they get very muddy. But the deoxyzine, the thing that I love about the deoxyzine is even when it's at its darkest, it's very rich, very intense. And also something you'll notice is, and it's something that I always try to tell my students, I want to work with a brush that's just too big for what I'm using it for. And the reason why I do that is because it's going to force me to look at the broad strokes. It's going to force me to look at the big things. If I start working with us, I think the smaller the brush you're using, the less of the art you're capable of seeing. So if I force myself to use a kind of a big brush, it means I'm looking at more of the piece at once. And the cool thing about this is, even at this point in the game, you can really see that because this is a color drawing rather than a painting, I really want every part of the drawing to kind of work, even at this stage. And for something like this bow, I'm not going to really do it as a painting. I'm going to do it as a drawing. So I want to really kind of jump in here, very almost cartoony, establish those highlights. So I'm going in and I'm kind of like establishing the highlights and getting the paper wet, and then I'm gonna go back in again while the paper's wet. And just let the paint kind of do a little bit of blending for me. In fact, throughout this piece, I'm gonna be doing this technique where I'm gonna wet something and then go back over it after it's wet and kind of allow it to do a little bit of the blending. That way I don't have to absolutely kill myself with coloring everything. And those are the darks. And the darks are absolutely established. You know, you can see the illustration very clearly. And what I'm gonna do now is kind of go in here and establish this kind of satin finish on her bustier. And we're getting pretty far away from the subject down here, so.
Yeah, don't want to draw the eye away from the eye.
Yeah, the funny thing about it is like, not only are we far away from the subject, but we're at a place that people are naturally interested in.
Looking.
So the eyes want to go here. So, you know, I want to do this slightly lighter than I'm comfortable with.
For all those Doctor Who fans, Louis saying bow ties are cool.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, but you notice with the new Doctor, nobody's saying bushy eyebrows are cool. And that man has some wild eyebrows.
Really? That means he's wise.
It means he's insane is what it means.
Right, and and I've gotten that in. I'm gonna just kind of go through and kind of establish some other darks that I want. And I really would like for that face to kind of turn. So over here in the shadowed areas, I'm gonna put in a little bit of a color. I don't want to go too dark early on, but you know, I want that nose to kind of like really stick out of there. So I want that side of the face to kind of drop off. So I'm like going through and making sure we're getting some dimension in that face. And really going out of my way to establish a separation between the neck and the head here, dropping the shadow of the jawline on there. Now later I'm going to come in and do a little bit more work on this to to really kind of enhance things a little bit, but also pretty early on, I want to, you know, kind of establish like the softness of the hairline. I'm gonna push that just a little bit darker. But at the same time, I want to turn that side of the neck away because it's being cast in shadow and establish a little bit of anatomy there. But also suggest the hair. This side of the shirt is going to be, not shirt, but the bow tie, that's going to be in shadow. So I want to go ahead and establish that. And I also want to establish the shadow cast on her. From the bow tie there. So we're getting a really nice path so far. And again, we want to have some real dimensionality to the nose there. So I want to establish like a bottom to that nose. And I'm going to turn that edge just a little bit. And to get those eyes nice and hooded, what I'm going to do is just drop a tint over that whole area. Also going to drop a little bit there. And again, we talked about the eyes a little bit in the last session. And I want to do a little bit more of that in this session. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead in and darken the whites of the eyes. Which always seems a little weird to me, but like you have to have it or it ends up looking a little odd. And I'm going to do the same on this side too. I'm not going to leave the whites of the eyes white. I'm going to go dark with the whites of the eyes. And this way I'm kind of establishing a little bit of hierarchy here. So the whites of the eyes are darker than the iris of the eyes. Fine, let me get it even darker right there in the corner. So that means those iris, the iris of her eyes are really going to stand out. And I've got like a kind of a slight micro expression on her. She's got a little bit of a frown, a little bit of giving away that she's not entirely what she seems. And again, let me establish like a little bit of depth to this forehead. But I don't want to do too much, and I really want her to come off as being very blonde. And surprisingly, to have her come off as very blonde, what I need to do is I need to set up a pedestal for that blonde. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go in and cut a shadow on her hair. I can't go lighter on the hair, so what I'm going to do is go darker around the hair. So what I'll do is I'll come out here. Sort of break up the silhouette of the hair here. In fact, we can go a little bit darker on that. And still, all of this with the dioxazine.
And with that same big brush, too.
Yeah. This brush is uncomfortably large. So by going a little bit darker with the background, I give room for the hair to sort of stand up a little bit. And I'm also going to go in and do some things to kind of like really, I think, in order to really give that hair that nice sort of blonde quality about it, anything that I can do to sort of set that up is good. So kind of the under tone where the hair is being cast into shadows from the hair above it. I'm going to go ahead and darken that up as well. And for this, you can actually go like relatively dark. In fact, let me go nice and dark in here. Give the eyes kind of something to pop off of. I mean, really, all of this is black, white, gray composition. You know, if I want something to be light, I need something dark behind it. Okay, so I'm real happy with the path so far. Again, we're getting away from the subject, but I think I'm going to need a little something up there just to finish that path off. So I'm not going to do a whole lot of work, but I'm just going to kind of darken that up a little bit. And kind of do a little bit of silk wrinkling in there. But it's not enough to finish the drawing, but just enough to sort of, like I said before, get you to collaborate with me on the drawing. This stuff up here, I don't want it detailed. I just want it to be believable. Once you believe it, then I want to get out of there. I don't want to work on it anymore after I've got your belief on it.
Louis says, forget Sunday night television. This is way better. Brian has his own show.
Very cool. All right. I think we've got most of the important stuff, like established. Got most of my, you know, the real shapes that I want to establish. And everything so far is done with fluid acrylics. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to sort of switch over to using watercolors to establish everything else. So the fluid acrylics, really, that's there to represent most of my hard edges. So now I've got all the hard edges in there. As I'm painting, there may be situations where I need to go back and establish harder edges or go back to establish different things that I might want to do with acrylics. But for the most part, I can get away with just about everything else with watercolors. And something else that I want to do on this, just to make it different. I always try to kind of put a little something different on there. I want to go with some lighting that's going to be kind of not just simple, just in-your-face lighting, but I want to go with something a little bit more ominous. So what I'm going to try to do is is bring some backlighting in on this, so that her face is actually you're seeing that from a backlighting situation, and most of what we're looking at is kind of secondary, you know, or bounce lighting into her face, but there's a major light that's coming in from behind her. Okay, and as far as watercolors are concerned, I have a tin that and this tin may be just as old as some of you out there, but it's an old schminky tin, it's got a combination of. In fact, I don't think any of these are schminky colors left. I think maybe some of these are earth tones here might be schminky, but this tin has been around so long, I can't guarantee that. But what this is a combination of kind of the Germans. I've got like a little bit of Lucas watercolors in here, a couple of schminky watercolors in here. There's this color and this color are from a company called Kremer that's in New York. You can just go to Kremer Watercolors or Kremer Pigments and get watercolor pans from them. They're some of the best watercolors in the world, I think. And the rest are going to be from Holbein, which is actually a Japanese company, but it has a German name, so I'm still good at saying that. it still counts by saying it's all German. Yeah. So I've established all my, hardcore stuff. What I'm going to do is I'm going to now kind of wash in some of the big values. I'm going to wash in some of those values to kind of like establish where I want this piece to go. In fact, I'm going to even go to a bigger brush on this because my big brush isn't big enough. And in actuality, this is an Escoda brush. It's really a very nice brush. I have no idea where I got it from because, man, I wouldn't buy something like this. But it's the biggest one that is within reach right now. So I'm gonna go for it. And with watercolors, the first thing that you want to do is you want to go through and get rid of all of, like, I like kind of going through and flattening out the color that I'm going to use, so that I think of it as surrounding the white. You know, you want to surround the white first, and after you've got the white nice and captured, nice and surrounded, then you can kind of start to bring in some of your other colors. And what I'm doing is I'm going for kind of a sneaky backlighting on this, which is going to be a little bit on the tricky side. So what I'll do is the areas that I know are going to be draped in shadow, I'm just going to go ahead and put those in there first. And again, you know, I'm not trying to kill myself with the details or anything like that. I'm just going to get in there and establish where the whites stop. Later, I'm going to come in with some of my more intense colors and actually get those in there. But right now, I'm just wanting to kind of surround those whites. I like the idea of that big giant, you know, sort of dew kind of like turning. So I'm gonna really get in there and establish like that big turn there. And I'm really thinking about, again, even though it's hair, I'm really thinking about anatomy. You know, like how does the anatomy of this hair working? How's, you know, what's causing those turns to happen? And with this, I'm gonna, you know, start off like I've done with my medium tones. Then I'm gonna kind of get in here with a little bit of a orangey yellow. I can't go straight up yellow, but what I'll do is I'll push it as far as I can. Yeah, what I'm trying to do is really kind of get in there and kind of establish these like hard values and hard shapes so you can really see kind of the anatomy of things. And now for this last part of the hair, I'm gonna crank that up right to the edge of yellow. So I'm getting those little turns in there, getting those little bits of lightscape happening, but you know, just really want that bloom of yellowy orange to kind of like come down into the hair. So it gets really soft out here on the edge. Again, I've established my medium tones on this, my medium and light tones, and I still have yet to establish the absolute darks. And now right in here, I want this to, I want this edge up here to be really soft. So I'm gonna kind of go in a little bit, kind of soften that out a little bit, and then go in with some of that real light yellowy orange. Just kind of bloom that color in as much space as I can. So I really kind of establish that sort of blonde look. And all this stuff out here on the edge. Gonna get in there and get that. And now that my nice medium values and light values are established, and I'm getting the effect that I'm looking for, I'm gonna crank it up even more. Because I really want this to just have a very hard shadow cast. And because my board is wet, it should have like a nice bit of room to kind of play around in here and really get those layers of color. And I'm going to go ahead and kind of establish like the feeling. Oh, got my giant head in the way. I'm going to go ahead and establish the real feeling of locks of hair. And I'm not really concentrating too much on strands of hair, but just big locks of hair. Now that I've worked my way up to the light, once again, really establish working my way down to some of the darks here. Now at this point, I'm trying to work really quick because the board is trying its best, like this watercolor paper. And every watercolor paper has its own personality, but this, the personality of this paper is it's trying to dry faster than I can paint.
Which is not always the case.
Like Arches watercolor paper gives you like years. I mean, it just takes its sweet time to dry. So you have like all the time in the world to kind of get in there and do all the detail that you want, which is good, but it's also bad. So with this, I'm really kind of like taking advantage of the fact that it wants me to not leaf around. Now I'm going to establish those final like darks on the hair. And again, I'm thinking in terms of locks, and I'm thinking in terms of really letting the watercolor paper do some of the work for me. I'm kind of pushing things down and letting the watercolor paper move it around for me. A lot of people say they have a hard time with watercolors, and I think people that come from oils where you have to make all the decision for the oils, you have to tell it where to go. Watercolors is a very collaborative medium. You have to kind of not tell it where to go, but you both agree on where things kind of should be. And if you can kind of collaborate with the watercolors, you get some really good stuff. But if you try to take control of it, it's gonna kill you. This edge up here, still very wet. So I kind of get to go in and still soften that edge up. Up here, still nice and wet, so I get to kind of jump in there and play around. Get some nice hard edges or soft edges. And what I'll do is I'll establish just kind of a few dark locks going through some of this lighter stuff. Get a nice little bit of depth in the hair there.
That's nice.
And something else, and again, it's going to be a black, white, gray composition. Something else I want to do is I don't want to just leave that kind of hanging out there, because it won't feel right. So what I'm going to do is go in with a very light blue. And even though it's a light blue, it's a light neutral blue. And what I'll do is I'll just kind of enhance that a little bit. So what I'm going to do is just take some of this light blue. And just ghostly establish that edge out there. So it's not, is that Hoyt?
I don't know. Michelle said she was going to write. So.
Ah, that's all Michelle. What?
She said you were going to write.
So how's it going?
Ah, pretty good. So because I've ghostly established that edge, that means back of that hair just really gets to kind of stand out. And I'm going to kind of continue it in here. And because I've got that shape there, what I'm going to do is really lightly establish it down here as well. So it's just enough blue to kind of notice it, but not enough blue to call too much attention to itself. Okay, so I've got a nice kind of path going through there. Okay, and now let's get some nice flesh tones on her. And my first order of business again is to get rid of anything that isn't going to be white. So I'm gonna back up like a good percentage of the face that isn't white, and just get rid of it. So I'm gonna go through and kind of, at this stage, surround my highlights. So I know that I'm gonna have a really nice highlight on the nose here. So I can go ahead and surround that. I know that at this stage in the game, most of the nose is going to be a color, so I'm going to go ahead and knock that out. And a lot of this is just, you know, anatomy, just kind of knowing where things are. I'm going to put a little bit of a light there. I'm going to establish a little bit of light at the corner of her nose and her smile, the rib of her smile. I'm going to leave that. Back here, I'll do a slight highlight that I'll leave on her cheek. And then right under the, right in the corner of that smile, I'm going to leave a highlight. And right there on the chin, I'll leave a highlight. And the coolest thing in the world is finding out where those highlights are. You know where those highlights are? It makes things a lot easier for you. And this is even before I start actually painting. This is just kind of establishing a base for the painting. And what I'll do is I'll take this flesh tone, and I love this flesh tone. This is a Holbein flesh tone that I'm using. It is slightly opaque, so even when I'm working on something like this paper, which is kind of a gray, it's just awesome how it just brings out those tones. Now I'm gonna go from here, and I'm gonna establish a little bit of a reddish pink. Yeah, reddish pink. I'm going to first and this is an opera pink, which is just crazy intense. I'm going to establish a little bit on her cheeks here. And what I'll do is I'll over-establish it a little bit over on this side, kind of back that edge up there. Get back in here, make sure we're covered. Through here. And again, what I'm doing is I'm surrounding those highlights on the nose. That gives me my basic kind of real light fleshy red, a little bit of blood under the skin there. And it's something that that I personally do because, you know, I think it gives a little bit of personality. I like going in with something even more red. I like to use that red to go in and establish the anatomy of the nose. And the cool thing about this red, once I get to the point where I'm using this, I'm not really being very, especially if I'm using it on the nose, I actually want to even try to get some of those cuts in there, get some of those cut edges. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put it in other places right now because I want it to, I want the nose to dry so I can get some of those edges down. So what I'll do is the lips, I don't want the lips to be white and the highlights. I want the highlights to be a little bit pink on the lips. So I'm going to go in with this red at first and just back those highlights, like the entire lip. Back it up with a pink. So when I come in with that really, really red later, the red that I have on there already will look like a really nice light highlight, but it's not going to be a white highlight. It's not going to compete with the stuff that I want to be white. And what I'll do is I'll take some of this red. Since I've got it in play, I'll actually use it to kind of enhance this side of the face a little bit, like the make it look like the flesh tone is kind of glowing into that hair a little bit. Since I've got it on the brush, put a little bit in the hair here as well. Right, and that's given me enough time for the nose to dry just a little bit. So what I can do is I can kind of come back and establish those cuts. And again, I mean, I wish I could explain exactly what those cuts are, where those cuts go, but everything's going to change based on anatomy, angle of lighting, all sorts of stuff. So there's no way I can kind of say, oh, it's going to be done just like this.
That just comes from years of experience, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, all years of experience. And the thing that that helps with experience, which is ready reference.
Yep.
So if you have years of experience, apply those years of experience. If you have reference, apply that. And the cool thing about it is some of these things are very deliberate. Some of these things are very, that's what actually happens with anatomy. But surprisingly, a lot of other stuff, it's just stuff that I do that I find just works. It just looks great on a portrait when you do it. And that comes from just doing it enough times and finding out what works and what doesn't work. So I'm liking the way she's going.
Oh, yeah. Everybody's still hanging, too.
Yeah. And now what I want to do is I want to, you know, I've got, and it's the same with the hair, where I establish my medium values, then I go in and I get my lighter values, and I go in and I get my darker values. With the hair, with the face, I've gotten a lot of my medium values down, and I'm really happy with the way they're going. But I still haven't put in my darker values. I've put in my color enhancements in some areas, but my darker values are still yet to show up. So let me go ahead and put in just a few of those. In fact, what I do with the face is a combination of doing my medium values, medium sort of values with color, then darker values, and then I go in and I do my lighter values with color last. And I love when I get to the point where I'm doing the lighter values with color, because those are the colors that really end up putting a little life in the face. Right now I'm kind of doing a little bit of yellow ochre, so I can kind of turn the face into the hair. Eventually I'm gonna work my way to burnt sienna, but I'm gonna take a yellow ochre stage because the yellow ochre has just a little bit more intensity before I get to the burnt sienna. And again, I'm just gonna take that yellow ochre and I'm gonna drop it right over some of this stuff over here. And again, we get in and establish some anatomy here. I'll get that micro expression in there. Get that turn of the face just right. And this is like really just kind of looking things out, looking at things, kind of figuring things out, knowing where you're going to go dark with things. And I'm just setting up the darks right now, not going to the actual darks. That's the whole game with watercolors, is slowly working up to those darks. So I'm kind of establishing that stuff. And again, over here, I'm going to establish some anatomy here. But I want this stuff to be kind of a graphic, so I don't want to really get into it too much. How are we doing with, of course, I shouldn't say that we've been up and going for a while, because...
Yeah, because the number two,
I don't want it to take a dive. And
you seem to be holding steady, Captain.
And what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back over on this shoulder here. Again, that's an area where the skin kind of gets a little close to the bone. So because the skin gets close to the bone, I want that to have like a nice bit of a rosiness to it. So I'm going to bring in that color there. And it sort of acts as part of the drawing. Okay, and now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and establish her lips. That way, if I need her lips to be any darker, I'll be able to easily take it down with another color. So what I'm going to do here is really establish kind of the highlight pattern in her lip with this color. And this is like very, very red. So you can see that is no holding back red there.
Yeah, that's a nice harlot lip.
And what I'll do is I'll kind of go in here. And that's the cool thing about working with that dioxazine, is that dioxazine ends up being
the color of whatever you put on top of it. So even though I establish that lip as that purple, once I put that deep red on top of it, that lips become just a nice dark red. And now to get the lip to turn around, what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back with an even darker red. And I'm going to go ahead and put that on there while the other red is still wet. Just to get it to turn the way I want it to. Because her face is really getting established here. Now what I want to do is I want to get a nice blue base on her eyes. But I got to be careful about that because I don't want it to be anything that's going to compete with the color that I'm going to have in her eye, in the eye itself. So what I'll do is I'll take the same neutral blue color that I used in here and sort of establish that. And just really kind of cool those eyes down. And since everything else is way on that side of the color wheel, putting that blue in there really kind of brings your attention right to the eyes. But this is a neutral blue, so even though it's bringing your attention to the eyes, it's not. I've got another trick that I can go a little brighter with. I've got a slightly brighter blue waiting in the wings.
So Scott Green said that if you'd keep working, he'll bring you dinner, but it's 10 hours from Utah to Atlanta.
Again, the eyes themselves, I want to do that whole thing with having the light go through the eyes. But this is the eye. This right here is just, an eye that's kind of hanging on, wishing to be famous. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this eye down a little bit. So I'm going to go ahead and put a little blue in there. This blue's got a little bit of a neutral in it, so it's not going to be quite as bright. And then what I'll do is up here, I'm going to go ahead and surround my highlight and put some dark blue on the edge of that highlight. So right where the highlight is, I'm going to go even bluer. And on this eye, same thing. Right where the darkest part of the eye is, right where it vanishes up into the eyelid, I'm going to go even darker on that. So now I've got that blue.
A little closer and get those eyes.
Yeah, so I've got that blue in there. Everything's really working for me so far. So now let's get a little bit darker. In fact, even before I do that, since I've got that neutral blue out, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a little bit of that neutral blue and sort of back her collar up. So kind of as the collar goes into the shadows, it's kind of bringing out some of that blue. And at the same time, I don't get to have, very, very purple, into a... we kept the voice. So we got the voice, and it looks like we're gonna have.
Oh no!
Hey, we're back.
We're back. Nice.
We're back, and it's all good. All right. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna keep kind of establishing stuff.
So again, you know, what I want is I want to cast the shadow of that hair sort of down onto the collar. You know, and it's pretty much a graphic. There's not much to it. But I think it really kind of gives it like a little something extra. All right, and the face is turning, but let's start to get a little dark with it. First place I'm going to go is with my burnt sienna. And the cool thing about doing a portraiture this way is the more and more and more you go darker, I think the more three-dimensional things become. I'm going to go ahead and establish the darks here. And since I'm going darker, what I'm doing is I'm getting rid of more and more of that deoxyzine and really making that deoxyzine into flesh tone. So that just kind of brings up the intensity of the skin. So even this stuff down here underneath the bow, it's like a little bit gray, but once I go in with that burnt sienna, really kind of gives it a nice little enhanced quality.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it looks like skin in shadow.
You know, going to pay attention to the anatomy. So the corner of that that mouth there, I really... You know, right now it's mostly established with drawing, so you kind of get in there a little bit and boost up her smile just a bit. As far as doing watercolor pieces are concerned, this is my favorite part because at this stage, just about everything you do just completely changes the illustration. Again, to really sort of push that hair out a little bit, I'm going to go in and establish those shadows that I set up. And I'm going to leave those light strands of hair in there. Depending on how things are looking, I might even kind of go in with Prismacolor. And here I can establish those edges again. But I don't want it to be like a clean, hardcore separation between the face and the hair. I want it to be nice and soft like that. So that's kind of working for me. Okay, and now for the last level of dark with the flesh tone, I usually leave that to alizarin crimson. Alizarin crimson is one of my favorite because not only is it dark, it's dark, and again, like the deoxyzine, it's a dark, rich watercolor. You know, but it like hangs out in that sort of deep red going into violet neighborhood. But because it's so dark and so intense, it's just a great color. And what I like doing is some of that deoxyzine that I kind of set up the eyes with, the eye over here, because like I said, this eye is not so much important. I'll let the deoxyzine go over there. But this eye over here, I'm going to kind of bring that, settle that that deoxyzine down with some of that alizarin. Again, right now, I don't know how clear you guys can see it, but this eyelash is pretty purple. So what I want to do is kind of come in here and put a little deoxyzine in there and get that under control. And now I'm going to get a little deoxyzine up in here, a little bit of the alizarin in here, just to sort of soften the eyes as it falls into the shadows. And I really like that alizarin because it's like a nice, warm, soft turn. You know, just a little bit there that turns it. And again, everything about this, all of the serious darks are happening right here. So everything about this is to kind of push your eyes right into her eyes. So I'm going to sort of darken things around her eyes so that it really kind of sets that stage up. Again, checking myself to make sure my anatomy is going right. What I'm going to do is go a little bit darker right on the corner of the hair. I don't have to take it down here, but right up here near the eyes, I want that to be a little bit darker. Again, it's really to hold your attention up here. I'm going to do the same thing on this side. You know, I don't need to go down in here or anything like that with this. I just need it up here where I want the attention to be. Okay, and what I'm going to do here is I'm going to see if I can back up the whites of the eyes over here just a little bit more. You know, so that eye is clearly on the stage. And what I'm going to do is, again, I'm going to get in here and take her teeth and kind of back that up a little bit. And I'm going to take that deep alizarin crimson and use that to turn this side of the mouth. All right. Hey, look at that. All right. And now what I'm going to do is just do a couple of like little touches here. I want to sort of bring the bow tie down a bit. So I think the purple there is a little bit too much.
Anna says your voice is so soothing she dozed off there for a minute. That's because we can't be rude because we're on YouTube now.
Uh-huh.
If we were on the Justin TV, we got rude and everybody was able to, you know, be a little louder and boisterous.
That wouldn't be so soothing. Yeah. All right. Yeah, it's almost like you can't help going Bob Ross to a certain extent on this. Okay, we've got all of the main darks established.
That's a nice shot.
Okay, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna do like just a little bit of line art. Actually, in fact, before I do line art, what I want to do is go in with a little bit of a yellowy orange, and just get some sort of little enhanced parts of the flesh tones. And it'd be nice if I did this with a cleaner brush. And really what I'm going for here is just those little areas where the skin kind of turns and the color makes these quick little shifts. And again, this is from paying attention, careful attention to reference or experience. What I have is just a little bit of yellow orange on the brush, and it's not really covering areas completely. It's covering areas that get like a little bit warmer. Like I've noticed that this area tends to get like a little bit more yellow. Down here, you get a little bit more. And like I said, that comes from just doing it enough times or knowing it or having good reference at showing it. So, it's going to establish that. And what I'm going to do, and again, just about ready for the brightest blue, but what I'm going to do is get the water changed out, and I'm going to establish all of the Prismacolor work that I want to do.
So while I'm leaving, one of the questions was, when you've done likenesses before, has anybody celebrity-wise ever seen the likeness and commented on it too?
Yeah, actually that's happened a couple of times. The coolest time that happened is when I did a portrait of Felicia Day, and you know, I was really happy with it. It ended up making it into one of my sketchbooks one year, and you know, I was under the impression that that was it, and it was all cool. But you know, about a year or so later, I'm hanging out at Dragon Con, and a really good buddy of mine, Jason Palmer, kind of comes up to me and says, "Hey Brian, how you doing?" And I was like, "Hey, Jay, what's up?" You know, we're just kind of having a good time, and he says, "I've got someone who'd like to meet you," and somehow, like a magic trick, he produced Felicia Day, and I was just like, "Whoa!" You know, and she just kind of walks up and says, "Yeah, I heard you did a portrait of me," and I was just like, "Oh, okay." And so I pulled out the book and showed it to her, and she was really happy with it. In fact, it's kind of cool because what she did was she got a copy of the book, and while she was getting a copy of the book, you know, she said, "Hey, can you sign this copy for me?" And I was just like, "Well, yeah, of course." You know, and after I signed the copy for her, I was just like, "Wait a minute, can you sign a copy for me?" So it was really kind of a cool exchange. And man, she's just absolutely the coolest, you know, most gorgeous girl. So it was really fun. But that's one of the coolest times that that, you know, it's gotten back to me that that my work has been checked out by some of the people that I sneak portraits of. And this is again establishing just those few turns. And this is something I really love doing on people with blue eyes. It's kind of a weird cheat, but I think it just really adds a little something. What I like doing is taking the highlight of a person with blue eyes, And I'll, in fact, let me do it with an even lighter. If a person has blue eyes, a lot of times what I like doing is taking the highlight and surrounding the white of the highlight with orange. And oftentimes if I'm painting this, what I'll do is I'll put down some orange, like maybe some vat orange or something like that, and then waiting for that orange to dry, and then putting down some, a little bit of like maybe titanium white on top of it. And what that does is that just adds a little bit of a really cool discord to that eye, where you're kind of like seeing the actual, blue of the eye, but at the same time you're getting that like real discord that's created by having that that absolute striking orange against that blue. So in a sense, and again, I always try to, if I possibly can, set up a situation where I'm getting my highest contrast, my highest chroma contrast, all of that to stand right at the edge of where the subject is. So my darkest dark, my lightest lights, my highest chroma, and my greatest chroma contrast, and my greatest black and white contrast. I want that all to be sitting in one spot, and I want that spot to be the subject, if at all possible. Sometimes you can't really set that up. And again, red violet, which is my 994. It's just a really good kind of enhancing pencil. So I'm gonna use that and kind of establish a little bit more color, a little bit more of a framing color in the hair. And again, this is not something that I'm going to use to the point where it's a color, but it's something that once you see it, I mean, you won't see it unless you're looking at the original. But what it does is it really sort of enhances all the other colors around it, gives all the other colors around it just that much more power. And again, I'm kind of going through and softening. And I can do this with either, like sometimes I'll do it with Prismacolor pencils, sometimes I'll do it with the Faber-Castell markers. Well, anytime I have like a really dark against like a much lighter value, and that contrast is just a very sudden shocking shift, a lot of times I like either softening that contrast or going over that contrast with a brighter color. And what that does is that has the effect of both softening the contrast, but at the same time enhancing the contrast. So even with things like this lip here, I think that is a very, very dark, and it's against almost that white. So by going over it a little bit with this orange, I'm softening that edge, making it a little less cartoony, and kind of giving a little bit of an extra something to the piece. Again, even on something like this, if I go over that edge just a little bit, adds a little something extra to it. So now I've kind of like pretty much set everything up that I think I'm going to need to set up. I've got like a nice clean vat of water here. You know what? I can soften that edge just a little bit more. And if the Australian's still hanging around, this is a color that she's going to be very familiar with, because I was working on a piece for her. And actually needed to buy this blue specifically for her piece.
She posted a little while ago. She posted at 9:38, so I'm not sure if she we're an hour later, so cool.
But this is the most ridiculous bright blue that I can lay my hands on. And I gotta be kind of careful with this blue because it's so bright. And another thing that's nice about it is it's slightly opaque. So it really will stand up on a color when you put it down. So what I'll do is I'll just kind of wash a little bit of this blue in.
Okay. Yep, we're back. Sound and everything.
Very cool. All right, and this blue is just completely ridiculous. And that pretty much establishes my subject, and that kind of establishes the entire piece. What I'll probably end up doing is because of the opacity of that blue, what I'll do is I'll kind of go back and make sure the pupil's kind of well represented. In fact, what I'll do is I'll do that with a little bit of orange. So I'm just going in with the orange and establishing the edge of that pupil, making sure we're nice and bright. And after kind of like getting a real good look at that, what I'd like to do is I'd like to just really increase the contrast right at the edge of the eye near the pupil. I think I can get like even greater contrast. I'm gonna go in with a little bit more blue here just to kind of get that ring working for me. More blue there. I think that's doing its thing. Round this out down here a little bit. All right.
Tight on the eyes again.
Hmm?
So I'm going to go and tight on the eyes again.
Cool. And Robert's getting a good tight shot of things so he can upload it to the Yahoo page. And, like I said, we're probably going to get scans of both of these pieces tonight. And we'll go ahead and upload those to the Yahoo page tomorrow so you can kind of get a much more detailed look at it. All right. All right, and there we go. And this is a lot of fun, very different from the other piece. This is more of a color drawing, whereas the other piece is more of a painted piece. And give you a nice detailed look at how things turned out there. And you can see that that the eyes are very intense.
Yeah, a couple of people were commenting on it. As she went along, she got more and more devilish.
Yeah, she did.
Yes, she did. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, very, very happy with the way those turned out. In fact, let's take a look at both of those for a comparison. And the neat thing is for the most part, a lot of the design of the pieces, I mean, I didn't plan this while I'm doing it, but you know, this is kind of like structure here and dissolves here, structure here, dissolves here. So it's just kind of bookends to each other. But I thought they really turned out to be a lot of fun. I had a great time with this. This is something that we started doing like a while back, and we kind of like with all the deadlines for Damon, we haven't been able to do it for a while. But it was like really fun to get back to it while Robert's kind of visiting over the holidays and get into the studio. I mean, every time Robert and I are together, we always talk nonstop about this kind of thing and just kind of having fun, just hanging out in the studio. Riffing on things and you know, getting things done, but this was like just a blast. I really had a great time. A number of people wanted me to play around with this technique, and this is just such a quick and easy technique to play around with that I think it's really cool. Again, if you have any more questions, even after the stuff gets scanned and posted, let me know. I'll try to get to them and kind of really tell you what I'm doing here. I mean, I have no secrets. I just have a lot of fun while I'm doing this stuff. So I hope you guys had a really good time. I definitely had a ball while I was working on it. So until the next time we get together, it was really good hanging out. You guys take it easy.
Peace out, guys.
All right, bye.
One shot.